Analyst Professor Rommel Banlawi. Professor, thank you for coming to the show. You were at the Senate hearing.
Yes, I was.
All right. Is China the biggest threat to national security to date when it comes to the Philippines?
Right now, because of its reclamation activities in the West Philippine Sea, its actions are really threatening, but we should not be overreact that way. We should be cautious because there are opportunities where we can convert these adversaries into a friend.
Yeah. At this point, you believe it can be done?
It can be done as long as we can resume our diplomatic bilateral relationship with China.
But it like doesn't mean they'll stop.
They will not stop.
They will not stop.
Especially now that they have invested a lot in constructing those facilities in previously submerged and features. Now they have built artificial islands.
Yeah.
And there's no turning back on the part of China because they have established their foothold already.
Yeah.
So
now it's quite clear. I want you to discuss how far China has gone, considering the Philippines has gone the diplomatic and legal route.
Mm-hmm.
Internationally, we filed a case with ITLOS UNCLOS, no?
Mm-hmm.
Number one, yon. Number two, we have been asking ASEAN for its support.
Mm-hmm.
But then during the World Economic Forum, no less than Malaysia said, that's the ideal situation, but it's hard to issue an ASEAN statement against China because all of the ASEAN countries trade the largest with China.
Correct.
So what do we do?
First, on the international arbitration, it was right to do that because we received the appreciation of the international community for challenging the 9-line claim of China. We're the only country in the world who did that. But of course, with some repercussions, we got moral victory. We got the attention of the international community. We pushed China to the wall.
Mm-hmm.
We embarrassed China, and we have to face that consequence.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, we have to face the reality that China is the world's economic power.
Mm-hmm.
It's number one in terms of power parity, and it's de facto number one economy, although mm-hmm. officially it's still the United States. But China is growing very, very fast. Other neighbors are taking advantage of the economic prosperity of China.
Mm-hmm.
And we're the only country being left behind.
Mm-hmm.
We're being isolated in this economic prosperity of China.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to shift our gear by being more pragmatic. Okay. Now, in the arbitration, we gain a moral victory. The challenge now for us is to convert this moral victory into a legal victory. Now, if we got this legal victory, the greater challenge is to convert this legal victory into political victory. And because China is ignoring the process, and I think China will continue to ignore the process, the challenge now, if we get the favorable decision of the arbitral tribunal, is how to enforce this decision.
So how? All right. Now, during the Senate hearing, what really surprised me was coming from some sources, there was some discussion saying we actually don't need the United States to actually defend ourselves against China. That was part of the hearing.
Okay. First is the position of the United States when it comes to the South China Sea disputes. It reiterates its long-standing position of neutrality.
Mm.
But at the same time, there's a reality that we are an ally of the United States, and the United States is committed to build our capacity to defend ourselves. But at the end of the day, we have to defend ourselves.
Yeah, but yeah. I wanted to ask you, I agree. Didn't U.S. Defense Secretary Ash Carter say in an interview, I believe it was in Arizona, he had said that they did plan to send stealth bombers,
mm-hmm.
ships, aircraft carriers to the West Philippine Sea? Because they were very alarmed.
Yeah, those are just plans, but we don't know whether or not the United States will push through with that, considering the dynamics of relationship also between the United States and China.
But are we saying, I mean, coming from the Senate hearing, we don't need that?
I think that will only complicate the security situation in the South China Sea if you involve the United States.
All right, let's talk about that.
Yeah.
If the U.S. comes in the West Philippine Sea dispute, let's say just add presence.
Yeah.
What will happen to us then?
You said
it will complicate.
We will be caught in a great major power rivalry. We will be caught caught in the crossfire. We will be in between the competition of two major powers. In fact, that's the main reason why the Philippines is having this kind of reaction from China, because China thinks that we are allowing ourselves to be used by the United States in this major power rivalry. If you will look at the strategic location of the Philippines, China regards the Philippines as a buffer state of the United States, and we're allowing ourselves to be used that way. In fact, the reason why the China intensified its reclamation work in the South China Sea because of the fear that the signing of Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement will lead to the strategic encirclement of China, and China does not want that kind of situation to happen.
But then again, Professor, we're only looking at it from the point of view of the Philippines in a very myopic way, in a very insular way. All of trade, 40% of trade passes through the South China Sea.
Correct.
China does not have a major airstrip. Mm-hmm. The irony is the first major airstrip is in, what do you call that, the reef?
In the Fiery Cross Reef,
yes.
They are building one in the Fiery Cross Reef, which for me is very strategic because
That's
it is located
point.
At the epicenter of the Spratly.
Exactly.
But it has already an airstrip in the Paracel, in the Woody Island.
Yes. Now,
well,
the reason
now.
I'm asking this is it really the U.S.'s interest of having presence in the West Philippine Sea area, not because of us, but really because they have a campaign of the U.S. pivot to Asia? It's
correct.
About them.
Correct, correct. In fact, the main reason why the United States...
Right?
Yeah, that's right. You're very right, Karen. The reason why the United States is very much interested in the South China Sea because it wants to maintain the freedom of navigation in the area, because the United States relies on the navigational passages in the South China Sea. But China is saying that the freedom of navigation is not being hampered as long as the navigation will be done for economic purposes. But China is very wary of economic activities, of military activities in the South China Sea. And China now is determined to prevent any major powers to use the South China Sea for military purposes.
Okay. Now I want to ask you, you had said U.S. involvement or any other foreign involvement, let's put it to, if it is a non-claimant country involved, that's fair, no?
Correct.
It will complicate matters.
Yes, yeah.
But then wouldn't it also be unfair because China is far bigger? 1 billion people, they are massive. Militarily wise, they have grown 5% every year.
More than that. Yeah.
You're talking about ASEAN countries that are relatively small and spend very little on military as well. Isn't it the natural, it's really the bully and the bullied. Isn't the natural state of the bullied to go to a protector of some kind?
It was the
you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's the only Philippines who did that kind of strategic option. The rest of ASEAN members are doing a different track.
They are what are they doing? Yeah.
Like, for example, Malaysia, despite their differences with China, is cultivating very good relationship with China because of economic purposes. They are pursuing what they call as quiet diplomacy when it comes to the South China Sea issue. Even Brunei is also doing the same thing. That is why it's very difficult to mobilize Malaysia and Brunei to support the Philippine position, because they have this kind of productive relationship with China. Even Indonesia is also benefiting from the economic relationship with China, and Singapore for that matter. And even Thailand, which is a formal treaty ally of the United States, is having this kind of tactical moment with China because they want to take advantage of the economic prosperity of China. But the Philippines, we diverted away from that kind of directions. Other countries are hedging with China. Hedging means you place bets on both powers. You know, you cultivate good relationship with China, you cultivate good relationship with the United States, you get the best of both worlds for the benefit of your national interest. But in the case of the Philippines, we embraced our alliance with the United States. We enhanced our defense cooperation with the United States because we feel that our defense alliance will be our protective cover from the growing expansion of China in the West Philippine
Sea.
So,
Professor, I wanted to ask you, one of the, this is a well-known writer, Martin Jakes.
Yes,
and he wrote a book of When China Rules the World.
Yes.
His theory was that the Philippines in effect, is betting on the wrong country.
Mm-hmm.
He said on Head Start, the problem with the Philippines is you should be with your neighbor, which is China, instead of with the U.S.
Correct.
Because, do you agree?
Yes, there's a saying that it's better to trust your closest neighbor than your distant relative.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the saying. And other countries in ASEAN are doing that. As a scholar, I'm advocating for a hedging strategy, not a balancing strategy, because right now we're balancing. There are three types of strategies when we deal with major power rivalries, particularly with the United States and China. Yeah. Either you bandwagon, meaning you bandwagon with the rising power, and that is China.
Okay.
Or you balance China by strengthening your alliance with the United States, or you hedge. And in the case of the Philippines, we decide under the current administration to balance rather than to hedge or to bandwagon. During the time of President Arroyo,
I was going to say Gloria, she balanced.
Bandwagon. No,
bandwagon.
She bandwagon with China. That's why
I
we receive a lot of concessions from China. And
so it wasn't necessarily wrong.
It was not necessarily wrong, as long as you have a clear sense of your national interest.
Kasi what happens sometimes is when an administration is finished, you tend to now think, ay, kasalanan niya ni Gloria, kasi ginawa niya nun eh.
Mm-mm.
But now you're putting it in good context. What you're saying, it's either you hedge, you balance, you bandwagon.
You bandwagon.
Nothing is wrong, basta you know anong interest ninyo.
At the end of the day, it's your national interest that must dictate the strategic direction of your foreign and security policy.
But now, all ASEAN countries are hedging.
Correct. All ASEAN countries are hedging. But in the case of ASEAN located in the mainland like Laos, Cambodia, Myanmar, of course, we know that they are really aligning with China because of geographic proximity and long history of relationship.
Yeah, but in the case, region trend yun.
Yes, yeah. But in the case of the maritime Southeast Asia, Brunei, Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore, and to a certain extent, Thailand, they're hedging. In fact, look at Singapore. Singapore is very much pro-China in terms of economic relations, but pro-U.S. in terms of security relations. When the United States left Subic, Singapore offered its facilities for U.S. Navy to stay in the region.
Yeah.
It's part of hedging strategy. You place your bets on both parties so that you can pursue well your national interest.
Yeah. Okay. Now only the Philippines is doing balance.